Mira and Harper Audio present The Roaring Days of Zora Lily by Noelle Salazar. Performed by Natalie Duke and Jesse Vilinsky. For Zora, without whom neither this book nor I would exist.
1. Washington, D.C., 2023. The fluorescent lights blinked on in a domino effect, one after the other, a faint buzzing sound filling the room as I stood squinting in the unnatural light. I inhaled, taking in my small slice of heaven within the storied walls of the Smithsonian National Museum of American History. The long room with its high ceiling, soothing taupe walls and wood floors, weathered in spots from years of conservators standing and pacing as they labored over the works of great minds, brought a sense of peace as soon as I stepped inside. The museum had been my happy place since I was a little girl, when my mother would walk with me from our baby blue painted row house on Capitol Hill, her slender fingers wrapped around my pudgy ones. We'd wander past sprawling parks, melancholy monuments documenting history, to the austere but magical facade housing wonders my six-year-old eyes could barely comprehend. By the age of 8, I knew all the regular exhibits like the back of my hand, and waited anxiously for the monthly newsletter that arrived in our mailbox, telling us what traveling exhibits we could expect next. It was one such exhibit, a gallery of gowns worn by British royalty, that had burrowed itself inside me in such a way that a dream was born. "I'm going to work here one day," I told my mother, pushing back a strand of dirty blonde hair as I stared up at a jewel-colored gown once worn by Queen Elizabeth II. I was 12. I wanted to exist within these walls. It was my church, and I believed in its teachings wholeheartedly. I had drunk the water, read the great books, and prayed to the gods of knowledge and creativity. I wanted to be part of whatever it took to bring history to life for others. And for the past 9 years, that's exactly what I'd done. I stared at the scene sprawled out before me. "Sanctuary," I whispered, tucking a blonde highlighted strand of hair behind my ear. Gleaming table after gleaming table sat covered in silk, satin, lace, and velvet. Gowns and dresses and blouses, previously only seen on movie screens and in photographs, now lay delicately in wait of tending to, their sparkle and sinew, in contrast to the stark lights and tepid surroundings. Mannequins, my constant companions, stood at the ready, waiting for their moment. Thread in every color imaginable, like a rainbow of rotund spool soldiers on a rolling rack, waited to be chosen. Needles and pincushions, strips of bias tape, shimmering appliques, ribbons, seam rippers, clear drawers filled with buttons and clasps and snaps, and boxes upon boxes of straight pins, their colorful heads a happy bouquet of tiny plastic globes, were scattered across every surface. Peeking from where they'd fallen to the floor, rolled beneath furniture, and stuck, I bent to pull a pink-headed pin from the rug beneath my feet, in a variety of inconvenient places. The door clicked open behind me, and I smiled. "Good morning, Sylvia," a familiar voice said. "Morning, Lou," I said to the one member of my team who, like me, couldn't wait to get to work. Every day, my friend and fellow fashion-obsessed cohort, Lu Huan, and I arrived within minutes of one another, and a full half hour before anyone else. Working as conservators for the museum was a coveted get for us, a dream job that every morning caused us to rush from our respective homes, grabbing an insufficient breakfast on our way out the door, and wondering hours later why we were so hungry. We lost track of time constantly, surviving on coffee and bags of chips from the vending machine, and leaving friends and family waiting on us as we turned up late to holiday parties, dinners, and events we'd implored others to attend but couldn't possibly get to on time. And having forgotten to blend the concealer we'd hurriedly dotted on in the train, with paint under our nails and bits of thread or glue on our jacket cuffs. In lieu, I'd found not only the perfect work companion, but a kindred spirit. Over the 9 years we'd worked together, we'd enjoyed laughing over our shared love of no-nonsense ponytails and waxing poetic about old films and vintage fashion. We sat in her living room, or mine, rewatching the movies that had shaped us and sharing stories of our schoolgirl walls plastered with images of iconic women of the silver screen, while our schoolmates favored posters of half-clothed men. So, when the idea for the newest exhibit started floating around our superior's offices upstairs, we'd spent many a night poring over which films we'd choose if asked, and then deliberated, scrapped, and chose again, until we had the perfect array. Out of curiosity, we began to inquire with movie studios about the costumes we'd be interested in displaying, running into new obstacles with each call we made. Several times we chose a beloved film only to find half the costumes had been lost in a fire, were part of a decades-long legal battle, or were just plain lost. A travesty over which we consoled ourselves with a huge plate of nachos and a pitcher of margaritas. Eventually, the decisions about which movies to include boiled down to three simple things. Where were the costumes we'd need? Would they be available to us for the time required? And what kind of shape were they in? Once we'd gotten the green light that the exhibit was on, we finalized our list, made the calls, gathered confirmations, and began the design for the wing the costumes would be shown in. And then we waited, barely able to contain ourselves as one by one the garments that would be featured in the Hollywood Glamour exhibition arrived. We chose two movies per decade, going back 100 years to the 1920s. Every piece that had been worn by the female lead was sent to us from studios, museums, or estates. Once in our possession, my job as costume curator, along with my staff of seven, was to remove each gown or outfit from its protective garment bags or boxes and go over it with a fine-tooth comb, looking for tears, stains, missing buttons, and the like. We'd been working for months. Some of the more intricate gowns needed extensive rebeading or sequin replacement, and many of the older pieces needing patching inside to hold the outside fabric together. In two cases, we'd had to sew exact replicas of the linings and then carefully fit them inside the original, giving it something to cling to, extending its life. A pantsuit from the 40s had lost an outside pocket, and matching the fabric had been hell. The brim of an iconic straw hat that belonged to another outfit had been scorched by a cigarette and needed to be patched. Each garment presented its own set of unique problems, and we were giddy as we worked to solve each puzzle. With our intention for each item to be viewed from all sides, it was crucial they looked as flawless as possible. Thankfully, my team were experts in their field and excited at the opportunity to handle costumes worn by some of the most famous women in film history.
"Can't believe we're down to the final film,"
Lou said, running a finger over a strip of fringe hanging from a black evening gown.
"I think this batch is my favorite."
I nodded, taking in the room of costumes from the 1928 film The Star. Each piece had been worn by the iconic Greta Garbo and was the epitome of elegance and class, and a notable diversion from the designer's usual style.
"It's so odd Clemente changed her MO for this one film," I said,
tilting my head as I took in the distinct wide neckline featured in each of the eight pieces. Even a blouse and jacket had been designed to show off the actress's collarbones. The pieces were alluring, but Clemente had always been known for a more modest style. Michelle Clemente had been a well-known designer in the 20s and 30s, her signature style demure, with higher necklines and longer hems. But for this movie, she'd completely diverged.
"It is strange,"
Lou said, frowning. The studio must have wanted something exact.
Then why hire her?
I asked. Not that she didn't do a lovely job. The clothing is exquisite. I'd wear them all now and look fab doing it. I felt myself blush with pleasure at the compliment. Being tall and willowy had its advantages. Unfortunately for me, I had neither the opportunity nor the bank account to wear clothes as fine as the ones before us. Thanks, Lou, I said, bending to peer closer at the large white beaded star on the white satin gown that was to be the centerpiece for the entire show. Aside from the star, the rest of the fabric had been left unadorned, letting the beaded element shine before one's eye went to the skirt, which fell in soft, overlapping layers to the floor. It was a stunning piece of art, but a confusing one, because it had no resemblance to any piece ever sewn before by Clemente. At least, not any piece I'd seen in my years of studying the different famous designers. It didn't have her specific way of hand sewing, or her distinctive technique of tying off a knot, or even her tendency toward geometric shapes. But it was the neckline that really threw me off. Clemente had preferred to leave a lot to the imagination. It was her calling card during a time when everyone else was showing more skin. And yet for these, she'd completely gone off script. The rest of the crew arrived at 9 on the dot, and the quiet of the room rose to a dull roar as individual desk lights were turned on, loops donned to scrutinize the tiniest details, and we all began to sew, glue, and chat our way through the day. Still, I glanced up and winced as my back protested from having been bent over a table for the past hour. Lou stood, her coat over her arm, by the door. Everyone else had vanished. What time is it? I asked.
Nearly 7.
Shit. How does that always happen? I pulled the loops from my head.
You happen to be in love with a dress?
Lou said.
That's how. Story of my life.
Explains so much.
Does it?
I mean, it definitely explains why you haven't had a date with a real live human in a while. Only...
She gestured to the mannequin beside me. We laughed. She wasn't wrong. Lou was the only person who truly understood me. The only person, besides my sister, who I'd ever allowed to see inside my guest room closet, where dozens of scavenged vintage dresses, trousers, jackets, and hats hung, waiting to be delicately cared for like the ones I lovingly handled at work.
You gonna stay?
Lou asked, watching me as I looked back at the dress spread out before me. I rubbed my eyes and stared at the tiny white beads I'd been replacing. We'd named the dress the Diaphanous Star, and I'd been carefully sewing on one bead at a time for the past 2 hours. It was a delicate task, as the fabric they clung to was nearly 100 years old. I had to work slowly and thoughtfully to keep from shredding it. Yeah, I said, rotating my head. I want to get this star done. How'd you do today? I glanced over at the black evening gown she was working on.
I'm close, she said.
You can barely see the snag in the back now, and I should be able to replace the bit of fringe that's missing tomorrow.
Perfect, I said, reaching over to wake my laptop and clicking on the calendar. We are ahead of schedule, which bodes well should we have any catastrophes. Lou knocked a small wooden box holding scissors inside it.
Don't jinx us, she said, and then waved. See you, B&E.
See you, B&E, I said. B&E, bright and early. We'd made it up one day after the youngest woman in our group rattled off a bunch of acronyms as if the rest of us should know what they mean. We used it constantly. She didn't think it was amusing. This, of course, made it that much funnier. I pulled my loops back down and resumed placing the beads that formed the shimmering star. 30 minutes later, I sat up, set the magnifying glasses on the table, and arched my back in a well-deserved stretch.
"Okay, you," I said to the dress.
"Time to get you on a mannequin." Sliding my arms beneath the gown, I lifted it carefully and carried it to the far end of the table, where a mannequin with roughly Greta Garbo's 1927 torso measurements stood in wait, minus its arms, which would be attached once I got the dress on it. Unfortunately, the wide neckline made it hard to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.